Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. Dear brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ, today we shall speak about charisms of the Holy Spirit or charismatic gifts. The word charism has a general meaning and a more technical meaning. In the general meaning, the word charism means a favor or gratuitous gift. In the more technical sense, a charism is a gift freely bestowed by the Holy Spirit for building up the body of Christ. They are supernatural gifts that either enable what is humanly impossible, such as the healings or miracles, or enhance a natural gift, such as teaching or service, to a level of supernatural efficacy. In other words, a charism is a special ability given to Christians by the Holy Spirit mainly for building up the church. It is given not primarily for one's own sanctification, but for serving others. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 8 to 10, we find a list of 9 charisms given by St. Paul. Let us read that text. To one is given through the Spirit the utterance of wisdom, and to another the utterance of knowledge according to the same Spirit. To another, faith by the same Spirit. To another, gifts of healing by the one Spirit. To another, the working of miracles. To another, prophecy. To another, the ability to distinguish between spirits. To another, various kinds of tongues. To another, the interpretation of tongues. All these are inspired by the one and same Spirit, who apportions to each individually as He wills. Probably, we will never be able to make a complete list of charisms. Although St. Paul gives us this list of 9 charisms here, there are other lists given by St. Paul, like Romans 12, 6 to 8. So there are definitely more charisms than the 9 that are mentioned here in the text that we read just now. And so, we will probably never be able to make a complete list of charisms. The Holy Spirit will continue to give the church new charisms to meet the new needs. We shall now describe very briefly some of the charisms. And for each charism, we will also provide one biblical reference. Wisdom. It equips persons to arrive at solutions to specific problems and to make right decisions. 1 Kings chapter 3, verses 5 to 12. Knowledge. It equips a person to understand God, human beings, and the cosmos in a better way through intellectual engagement. Proverbs chapter 2, verses 1 to 11. Faith. It enables a person to have a great trust in the goodness and power of God and to act on that trust. Luke chapter 7, verses 1 to 10. This is different from the theological virtue of faith, by which all Christians believe in the existence of God and in all what God has revealed and in what is proposed by the church for our belief. Healing. It empowers a person to bring to the persons who are sick physical, psychological, or spiritual health. Some do it through prayer, while others do it through treatment combined with prayer. Tobit chapter 11, verses 1 to 19. Miracles. It empowers a person to do an extraordinary deed that cannot be explained by natural or scientific laws in order to promote the welfare of someone in need and to give glory to God. 1 Kings chapter 18, verses 16 to 40. Prophecy. It enables a person to communicate God's message to individuals or groups through words or actions that are inspired. It takes many forms, like a word of knowledge, a word of wisdom, a message received through visions or dreams, and the reading of hearts. Luke chapter 3 verses 1 to 18. Discernment of spirits. It gives a person to distinguish between divine or demonic presence, be it in persons, places or objects. Matthew 16:21-23. Tongues. It empowers a person to speak in a language or to make sounds that they do not understand, either for personal prayer or for giving a message to others. 1 Corinthians chapter 14 verse 5. Acts chapter 19 verse 6. Interpretation of tongues. If the gift of tongues is for giving a message, it has to be interpreted either by the one who speaks or by the one or by someone else. 1 Corinthians chapter 14 verse 13. Administration. It enables a person to plan and manage things in such a way as to bring about positive results. Exodus 18:17-23. Intercessory prayer. It enables a person to pray for the needs of others so that God's goodness, protection and liberation may reach them in amazing ways. Genesis chapter 18 verses 20-32. Teaching. It equips a person to assist others to acquire the knowledge and skills needed to unfold their full potential. Matthew chapter 28 verses 19-20. Some of the other common charisms are craftsmanship, celibacy, encouragement, evangelization, giving, hospitality, leadership, music. Some charisms, example teaching or leadership, look like natural talents. However, charisms are different from natural talents in the following ways. First, talents are inborn. Often they are inherited from one's parents. Charisms are given by the Holy Spirit. Second, talents can be used whenever one wants. Charisms do not become effective whenever one wants, but only when the Holy Spirit wants it. Thus, even great saints cannot effect healings whenever they want. Third, a natural talent need not be connected to our relationship with God, but a charism is always related to our relationship with God. Fourth, talents make us effective to some degree, but when the Holy Spirit enhances natural talents with the corresponding charisms, the natural talents, like teaching or administration, produce effects beyond what happens ordinarily. Some charisms like healing and prophecy and discernment of spirits seem to be extraordinary, whereas others, such as administration, service, hospitality, seem to be very ordinary. Even what looks like ordinary qualities are charisms if they are gifted by the Holy Spirit. Because a charism is always connected to our relationship with God, to determine whether something like administration is a charism or merely a natural talent, we need to ask ourselves questions like, am I becoming a better administrator as my relationship with God grows? When I look for ways to give visible expression to my love for God, do I feel inspired or nudged to enter the field of administration? Do I experience the work of administration as a way of bringing God's love, goodness and providence into the lives of people? In a similar way, for persons with the charism of music, music will be a very potent way of growing in and expressing their relationship with God. The Holy Spirit gives one or more charisms to every Christian for building up the kingdom of God. So there is none of us who is present here who does not have a charism. It is a mistake to think that charisms are given only to saints or to those who are in the charismatic movement. The charismatic gifts are given to us to fulfill the role that each of us has to play in making the kingdom of God grow. Each one's role is unique and so cannot be fulfilled by others. Just as each part of our body is unique and each part has to play its role in order that the body has to function well. And so we are obliged to use the gifts that we have received. Saint Peter exhorts the Christians saying, as each one has received a gift, use it to serve one another as good stewards of God's grace. The use of charisms, therefore, is not optional. It is a duty. If you do not use them, we will be like the lazy servant in the parable of the 10 talents, who was ultimately punished for not using what had been given to him. So it is very important that we find out which are the charisms that God has given us and use them in our Christian life. When we work using the charisms that God has given us, we become much more effective in whatever we are doing in our service. Charismatic gifts are given by the Holy Spirit during the sacraments of initiation, that is especially baptism and confirmation. And at other times in our life, which the Holy Spirit considers opportune. What can we do in order to receive charisms and in order to grow in charisms? First, thirst for the Holy Spirit. When Jesus spoke to the Samaritan woman about the living water, she asked Jesus to give her that water. The living water that Jesus spoke of is really the Holy Spirit. Like the Samaritan woman, we need to thirst and ask for the Holy Spirit. Second, long for the spiritual gifts. Some people think that since charisms are gifts given by God, it is not right to ask for them. Further, they consider that it may be a sign of pride to ask for charisms. It is true that charisms are gifts. However, this need not prevent us from longing for them and asking for them. In fact, St. Paul says, you must earnestly desire the most helpful gifts. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 31. And Jesus exhorts us saying, ask and it shall be given to you. Matthew chapter 7, verse 7. Pray the word of God. Third, pray the word of God and participate in the sacraments. With an attitude of openness to receive what God wants us to give, pray regularly the word of God and especially the text on gifts, fruits and charisms like Isaiah chapter 11 verse 2 and 3, Galatians chapter 5 verses 22 and 23, and 1 Corinthians chapter 12 verses 4 to 11. Pray Psalm 16 verses 5 to 11 for an anointing with God's gifts and nourish the spiritual life through devout and regular participation in the sacrament of reconciliation and the Eucharist. Let us conclude with a prayer to the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, you are the giver of all gifts and charisms. Come into us and dwell in us. Remain in our hearts and enable us to open our hearts to receive whatever you want to give us. May we be open to the gifts and charisms that you want to give us, and may we use them in building up the kingdom of God. You will live and reign forever and ever. Amen.